Guests on Keel heard via the Jack Spring Electric Keel Newsmaker Hotline. The latest of those is Louisiana's Attorney General Jeff Landry. Mr. Jeff, welcome back to Keel. Thank you, as always, for fitting us into the schedule this morning.
How are you, by the way?
I'm doing great. How are y'all doing?
Good. COVID, you're about over it?
I think so. I don't know. You know, I'm nine days into into my isolation, I guess you could say, or my quarantine. You know, I really haven't had any symptoms that I can speak of. Mm-hmm. Just kind of waiting to go back and I guess get retested. And other than that, you know, just sitting in my study and continuing my job.
Okay. You wrote a letter to the governor, highly critical of his mask mandate. Let me play you a little clip of the governor's attorney, Matthew Block, who was on with us yesterday, and then we'll get right into this debate. Here's what he had to say.
He said that he believed that the governor's orders at that point in time, which were significantly more restrictive than the current orders, were constitutional and advisable, and that he supported them.
Okay, he's talking about comments you made in March in support of his executive orders. What has changed?
Well, a lot has changed, Aaron. I mean, look, let's start from the facts, right? So back in March, we had a novel virus that was in the United States and in our inside of Louisiana that no one knew much about. We didn't know the infection rate, the mortality rate. We didn't know how to treat it. We didn't know what populations were affected by it, meaning from a demographic standpoint. Where are we today? We're in a much better shape. And then back in March, we were told by the experts that 2 to 3 million people here in the United States were going to die from that virus. So a lot was going on at that time. And here's the problem, is that every crisis and emergency, the response by the government outside of the normal statutes, laws, and constitutional rights that we have must fit the crisis and the emergency. And so in March, it was patently different from where we are today. Today, we know we have a better grip on what the infection rate is, what the mortality rate is, how to better treat it. I mean, our medical personnel have done wonders in the ability to increase the survivability rate for the virus. And in fact, they have shortened the length of stays for people that end up in the hospital over the disease.
Mr. Jeff, you wrote, we should not turn neighbor against neighbor. We should not attempt to turn our job creators into state-run police. Obviously, you think this is what the governor's done. Do you think this is something he's done purposely, a result of the mandate? Dig into what you think his mindset is in all of this, if you could.
Well, look, it's not what I think he's done. It's what he has done. If you read the executive order, and look, here's another very, very important point. I'm not taking a side against the governor. The governor's taking a side against the law and the Constitution. That's not my particular issue. My job is to go out there and interpret the law and to represent the state accordingly. We were asked by a number of representatives to give a legal opinion on the executive order that he issued, and he did. I mean, he basically turned the enforcement mechanism of the order over to business owners and said, if patron A does not violates my executive order, it's your job to police that, right? And again, that's problematic. You know, and I'll tell you something else, Rob and Aaron. Here's an interesting part. When the governor announced this executive order, if you go back and you watch him, he was asked a number of times by reporters about the enforcing of the order. And he sidestepped all of them. In fact, he said, I'm not interested in enforcing this order. And in some cases, he said, we would not be enforcing it over a particular class. That in itself, on its face, is unconstitutional. We don't pick and choose who we enforce laws on. That's not how our government works. And so I believe that the governor knows by his own by his own words, that what he wrote may have been aspirational, but certainly is, does not fit within the constitutional construct.
You know, local businesses took our mayor to court over his mask order. They won yesterday. The judge ruled on their side. Will this have an impact on what you do? Will you take the governor to court?
It's not my job to take the governor to court in this particular instance. The ability to check governors in this state resides with the people, the legislature, and the courts. The legislature certainly is within its right to be able to rein in the acts of his governor if they so choose. The people can take that governor to court, just like the business owners in Shreveport took the mayor to court. We've done our job.
Will the ruling in the Caddo case, could it be helpful in a case that is filed against the governor by business owners?
Look, I think we lay out a very strong case as to why the current mask order, the bar closures, and 50-person capacity order are unconstitutional. In many cases, they're vague, they're broad, they're arbitrary, the ability to enforce them is problematic at best. I'm not telling you that the governor can't do certain things, right? He certainly can. He can use a scalpel. He chose to use a sledgehammer in this facet, and guess what? It's just unconstitutional.
What do you say to people who say, well, that's what the medical professionals are telling him to do, Mr. Landry?
Well, first of all, the medical professionals are not lawyers. And certainly they have a right to tell all of us what we should do. And then we are supposed to decide what's best for our health and welfare. Business owners, let me give you an example. There's nothing there's nothing on its face wrong with business owners saying, hey, I'm going to put in a mask order policy in my store, right? Now, there's a couple of caveats. I'd ask them to talk to their lawyers as in regards to, you know, the ADA, American for Disabilities Act, mm-hmm. and some constraints with people who may not be able to wear a mask. They don't want to get in trouble. I'm not their lawyer, but they could. They could do that. You've seen that in many businesses out there. This is not the space for government to be mandating that type of conduct, but business owners can certainly do that inside of their private locales.
Mr. Jeff, there's been a little talk over the last couple of months. It was, I don't remember the exact term, the legislative term, but the proposal that was being sort of put forth by State Rep. Alan Seabaugh, that would, if he had a majority vote of either houses of the legislature, would null and void the governor's emergency order. Have you heard anything else about that, and can you speak to where that might stand?
Excuse me. Yeah, we have we've received the request for an opinion as to what the effects of the legislature doing so would be, and we're in the process of working on that right now. I mean, look, here's the problem that we're at. I don't know that the governor has actually sat down with the legislature and said, you know, look, we've got a problem. We've got a different crisis on our hands, and that's the whole problem, Robert. I mean, think about this. We know what we're dealing with now, right? We know the vulnerable populations. This virus is not going away tomorrow. We have to figure out how do we conduct our lives, how does our economy continue to operate inside of this epidemic or pandemic, if you would. We can't stay in crisis mode all of the time. And the governor can't say, well, let's, I mean, how long is the governor going to stay in a declaration of emergency? I mean, so far, are we in a new normal?
Well, excuse me, Mr. Jeff, pardon me a second. That's what was going to be my next and final question. The governor will address the state later today, and there are rumors that he may back it up and or tighten things up even more, taking restaurants down to 25%. Closing gyms, et cetera. Your thoughts on that?
Well, I mean, here's the problem. There's been no set of metrics that they've told us what exactly are they trying to achieve. Again, let's go back. You know, the governor keeps saying, well, the attorney general stood with me in March. Well, look, in March, here was a very objective goal. We need to flatten the curve. We need to ensure that our healthcare community is braced for this job, right? That the capacity will not completely be overrun. We had no tools at our disposal back in March. Where are we now? The federal government has given us billions of dollars, pumped billions of dollars inside of our healthcare networks to treat and to address the causes and effects of this virus. What are we doing right now about it? Are we managing that properly? What exactly are the goals? When do we go back to normal? Are we in normal? If we're in normal, that means that Title 29, the Emergency Declaration Act, is not applicable because we're back in normal time.